Strap in, guys. It's going to be a long one. So this is, I don't have any slides or anything. It's going to be a little different. So this paper felt like I was stepping into a different world, kind of.
Who are you?
Oh, yeah. My name's Alex. I help organize Papers We Love. Welcome, everybody. So I'm going to do a quick discussion about the paper, and then we can just talk. Yeah, it'll be super cash. It'll be nice and fun. So my experience connected to the paper. So the paper is like a social sciences paper, which I know nothing about. I have not a lot of academic background, so like reading studies and stuff like that is like, I don't really know how to like read a study and like know if it's a good study, you know, if that makes sense. Like qualitative analysis, I like don't know what that means. I don't know what that word means. Things like that. Study methods and research methods and things like that. Anyway, so my connection to the paper is it's about, how to describe it, it's so the title of the paper is Human Factors and Folk Models, and so it's kind of this intersection between these two things which I didn't know anything about, so I got to learn about those two things and then the intersection. So the first one is folk models, and that is the notion of things that you don't really understand how they work, but you kind of have a rough idea of how they work, and that's like enough to make things work for you. It's like how you explain the world around you without fully understanding what's actually happening.
What's an example?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So there's another paper. So okay, so the paper itself is not that interesting, but the things that it kind of prompts you to read about to understand the paper are interesting. So I'm going to talk about those things primarily. So an example, there's another paper that's referenced by this paper called Two Theories of Home Temperature Control. And it was this study that was done in like the 80s. And it was basically, so nobody learns how to operate a thermostat in school. You just kind of know how it's done and people tell you how it's done. And so they did this study. They asked people like, what happens when you turn the knob higher than the temperature of the room currently? And one guy, or one theory that a lot of people seem to have just kind of passed down from their parents or whatever else is like, when basically the higher it's set above the current room temperature, the hotter the air coming out of the vents is. So that's like, you know, is that actually true? I don't know. So basically if you want the room to be hotter, you just like, or if you want the room to get hotter faster, you just turn up the temperature like higher. You just keep turning the knob more. So it's like a valve. It's like you're opening a valve sort of thing. That's the valve theory of home temperature control. And then the other theory, which is, and again, these are like folk theories. They're just like what people have kind of picked up over time. And they don't know how, you know, feedback loops inside of the thermostat work. They just know that you turn the thing and the heat comes on, whatever. So the other one is a feedback loop. Is they kind of have an idea, which is that the furnace has one setting, and that's on. It's either on or it's off. It's full blast or it's not. Not on at all. And you set the temperature you want. And then when the temperature falls somewhat below, then the furnace comes on full blast and then brings the temperature back up. And so I don't know if either of those are fully accurate. I think there might be a little bit more going on with that. But basically those are the two kind of competing folk theories that are out there that people just have for how thermostats work in their houses. So that's the folk theories half of the paper, or folk models. Same thing, just kind of synonyms. A model is like a model of how something works. Folk meaning it's passed down between people. And then the other half is human factors, which is, again, a phrase that I hadn't even really heard before. And it's the idea that you have systems in your life. So either it's software you interact with, so you have programs on your computer, or it's systems you interact with, like paying a parking ticket. You have to like go to the parking store and like wait in line, and you have to fill out forms, maybe. Things like that. There's all these like processes that humans are interacting with. If you're like a manager and you have to hire someone, you have to conduct an interview, and you have to read resumes and call references, and these are just kind of like a fixed process that you participate in, and there's a bunch of humans involved in that process. And so if you consider the whole thing as a system, then the humans in it are the human factors in the system, and it's kind of this question of how the humans respond. You know, humans are complicated, so basically how does the system work for the humans and vice versa, and how do the humans potentially cause problems for the system and things like this. So if you've ever heard of the term user interface design or user experience or whatever, where you're kind of looking at a program and saying, okay, this is hard to use, how do we make it easier to use? That's like a really tiny view of human factors and the study of human factors and the practice of human factors, which is kind of, I guess, there's like some psychology that you have to know and all these different things. I don't know. Basically, like I said, stepping into another world. I like read this paper and I was like, whoa, people like do this for a living. They like think about how humans are involved and in like these really complicated systems that you don't even think of as systems where humans are part of it. And anyway, so for my notes really quick. So the intersection of those two things, backing up a little bit. The paper is about, it's a very specific paper. It's about two terms that get used a lot in post-mortems or like kind of lessons learned that happen when like airline accidents happen. So when airplanes crash, usually, you know, lots of damage is caused, it's usually expensive, sometimes people get injured or killed or whatever, so it's usually there's some thing that happens where people go back and they look at what happened and why that happened. So that's referred to as postmortem or kind of a lessons learned sort of thing. And that's like going back and looking at the black boxes in the aircraft. That's, you know, consulting with people who are involved, like air traffic controllers and stuff like that. And the idea is that you don't want that to ever happen again. And you have the benefit of hindsight at that point. You can, you know, you're able to go back and look at even like emails, maybe even like look up like engineering drawings and things like that. And like maybe where somebody said like, hey, this might be a problem. And then it wasn't dealt with appropriately. Like when you look at the Challenger rocket, I want to say, where there was like an O-ring that wasn't really adequate. And an engineer said, hey, this is probably a problem. And they said, oh, we have to get this done. Basically, we can't really, they didn't really believe them. So there's all these possible root causes and you kind of have to get to the bottom and figure it out. If you really want that to not happen again, you have to find out why it actually happened. And so the paper is about root causes where things are attributed to the people involved and the attributing is done via folk models of human performance. So that is when you say that someone lost situational awareness or they became complacent. Those are the two examples that the paper focuses on. It spends 8 pages talking about it. Basically, the idea is that the central theme of the paper is that when you use those terms, you kind of stop the analysis there and you don't really end with anything useful. So if you say that someone lost situational awareness, like you say a pilot lost situational awareness or they ignored something on their console and became complacent or something like that, because we all kind of have an idea, we have different ideas of how human performance works, even if you haven't really thought about it. You think about when people get too stressed or when they have too many things going on kind of in their mind and they aren't able to focus on the things that are important or they have too many things they have to remember. These are things that can cause your performance to suffer when you're doing some task. So basically, when you say that someone became complacent, that is kind of using one of these folk models of performance and you're saying that that's why it happened. And that's bad because then you end there. That's basically the end of the analysis. And it doesn't really tell you how to fix the problem other than to say just be less complacent or like be more vigilant. And so the paper is like, again, 8 pages of saying like, why does complacency cause a decrease in vigilance and things like this? And it's basically saying that the models are bad. Using folk models like that is bad, is what it's trying to say. So I guess I have a whole lot written down here, but so one other thing that was interesting in the paper was this idea of cognition ergonomics, which is designing things so that they're just like comfortable to the mind. And so basically it's like they give an example using this system called GOMS, G-O-M-S, which is kind of this way of modeling when you have, so it talks about a program, like a word processor, like Microsoft Word or whatever, where you want to like edit a manuscript, and then it uses the system to say like how do you measure how cognitively comfortable it is. So you have the set of goals. So the goal when you're editing manuscripts, so that's like your top level goals. I need to edit this manuscript. And then you have a sub goal, which is, okay, you have to find the first edit to make. And so that means you have to kind of comb through the manuscript and you have to look for spelling mistakes or grammar mistakes or whatever. And so one thing that happens in there is the task of flipping the page. So how easy is it to flip a page in Microsoft Word? That's something you can think about. Maybe it needs to be easier, because that's like a critical task when it comes to editing something, editing a manuscript in Word. Once you've found an edit to make, now you have a couple of, you have to select, sorry, not select, because that word has a meaning in Microsoft Word, you have to decide how you're going to carry out the edit. So if you want to delete a word, if you want to copy and paste some text around, if you just need to add a word or whatever, those are kind of operations. And so GOMS stands for goals, operations, methods, and then selection of method, which doesn't really tell you anything about how it works. But the idea is that you have goals, then the system you're using has operators, which you have to kind of combine to carry out your task. And then methods and selection of methods means that there is this some decision making where you have to say, okay, I know what I want to do. I have these operators available, which is deleting words, copying and pasting text, flipping through pages, things like that. How can I accomplish my task? And so it's kind of, it's this idea, it kind of gives you a way to model how many steps it takes to carry out an action, like, or carrying out a task, I should say, like editing a manuscript. So that was kind of interesting to read about. What else? Yeah, so okay, so there's a couple of cool examples from the paper where they talk about specifically pilots and a couple of real world examples. So I'm going to cover those really quickly and then I'm going to open it up, I think. So one quick thing is the idea that folk models are bad because they can't really be scientifically disproven. And so this is something that I never had a chance to study, but the idea of proving things by induction versus deduction, and how induction is kind of forward thinking, and you have a bunch of observations that you've made and you try to extrapolate and learn things about the world that way. It's like you see a bunch of white swans and you decide most swans are probably white, and then deduction is as soon as you see a black swan you know that not all swans are white, because you've just instantly disproved that theory. So with folk models, like saying that the pilot became complacent, you can't really disprove that that's true. That kind of applies in like every situation. And the paper has a whole bunch of examples where when there's a better analysis that's been done, you could replace the better analysis with just the pilot became complacent or the pilot became or lost situational awareness. And it kind of covers the same ground, but it can't be measured, it can't be disproven, anything like that. So it's kind of, basically you feel like you have understood something about what happened, but really you haven't. So it's one of those things where you read about it and you're like, this is crazy. Like, I've definitely heard people using these words before, but I never really thought about how they maybe didn't mean anything. So anyway, it's just interesting to think about. So the one example is frequently quoted, and this is quoting from the paper now. Hey, Matt.
Hello.
A frequently quoted sequence of events with respect to crew resource management is the flight of an iced-up Air Florida Boeing 737 from Washington International Airport in the winter of 1982 that ended shortly after takeoff on the 14th Street Bridge and ended in the Potomac River. The basic cause of this accident is said to be the co-pilot's unassertive remarks about irregular engine instrument readings, and then in parentheses, despite the fact that the co-pilot was known for his assertiveness. This simple explanation hides many other factors which might be more relevant, including air traffic control pressures, the controversy surrounding rejected takeoffs close to decision speed, which means that if you abort a takeoff after decision speed, which is something that aircrafts have as a property, it's if you're going faster than that, you can't really stop safely. And so if you abort after that, then that's like a big deal. That's a really bad thing that you shouldn't do as a pilot. So the controversy surrounding rejected takeoffs close to decision speed, the sensitivity of the aircraft type to icing, its pitch-up tendency, with even just a little ice on these slats, I don't know what those are, but part of the aircraft is, I guess, And ambiguous engineering language in the aircraft's manual to describe the conditions for when to use the engine anti-ice. So those are all things where you can actually fix those things. You can have more specific language about when to use the anti-ice. You can maybe make it more okay, or you can maybe, like, it, there's all these pressures that you could remove maybe so that the pilot isn't worried about those things. Something that Andrew pointed out to me earlier was there's things that pilots use to, it's like an acronym that it's kind of things you have to do to make sure that you're ready for flight. So making sure that you haven't had any like medicine that causes you to be drowsy recently, whether you've had enough rest, whether you don't have any, whether you're not kind of suffering from any emotional hardships from like a death in the family or something like that. There's all these things, and it's kind of this whole system basically that it's kind of making sure that everything is covered off. And then this is the last example that I want to cover is 1973. This was before the terms situation awareness and automation induced complacency were kind of being used a lot. So the aircraft in question was on approach in rapidly changing weather conditions. It was equipped with a slightly deficient flight director, which is a device on the instrument panel which shows how much you have to bank and how much pitch you need in order to maintain like a flight path. So the instrument is deficient. The aircraft pilot knew that and didn't really trust it. And then in a comment on the crash, so there was a crash, 89 people died, unfortunately. The Transport Safety Board explained how an accumulation of discrepancies, none of which were critical in themselves, had rapidly brought about a high-risk situation without positive flight management. The first officer who was flying was preoccupied with the information presented by his flight director, which was not working the way he was hoping it would, or should have been. And then that was detrimental to his attention to the altitude, heading, and airspeed controls. So that's a better analysis than saying that he lost situational awareness, that the crew lost situational awareness, or that the first officer, who was the one who was paying attention to all the other systems, became complacent. So those could stand in just as well. There's a couple of other examples in the paper which I think are less strong, and I think this might have been one of the examples of that. I feel like maybe the language, I feel like maybe there's some language that I'm just missing, or I'm missing the specifics of the language so that it would not feel that way, but basically, I found the paper interesting. The things that it caused me to look at was more interesting. That's about it. Anybody want to have any questions or anything they want to talk about? Or
why were you reading this paper?
To present at Papers We Love. That's a lie. So there's a blog I really like called Kitchen Soap, and it's a guy who does human factors work professionally. He has a couple of really good blog posts that just talk about how to organize people so that things run smoothly. He's focused on software projects, but he kind of just seems to really have some good ideas in general. And he referenced this paper. He said that this is kind of like a foundational paper in that kind of work. So,
did you say Kitchen Soap?
Kitchen Soap.
Okay.
Yeah. Kind of a funny name.
Before researching stuff for this paper, did you know how a thermostat worked?
No, never even thought about it. I saw the title of the paper, I'm like, that's amazing. Like, I love that somebody has studied that. Oh, that reminds me, there's another related paper, which I found as a result of reading this, and it's about home PC security. And so it talks about people's folk models of motivations for hackers, why hackers do what they do, why people write viruses. It turns out some people think that viruses are just to cause mischief, and so when people talk about taking measures to protect your identity, they don't really think that's important because they don't think that's why people write viruses. So basically, the study was about what people believe in terms of why viruses are out there, why hackers hack things, and then what security advice they choose to ignore. And so that was kind of like an interesting paper as well. So just the concept of folk models and the concept of human factors was really what I got the most out of this paper from. It was just things to read more about and kind of think about more.
Were there any other things you read about as a result of this paper?
Yep. So there was there's a great list of these kind of looking back things by Dan Liu, who's a performance engineer at Microsoft. He has it on GitHub. It's just if you just Google Dan postmortems, you'll find it. So one interesting postmortem, which is not really related to the paper, but I think is funny. What happened is from the website GitHub in 2012. So they have a cluster of database servers. One is active and a bunch are standby. So they're not running, they're just waiting in case something bad happens to the one that's active. They upgraded the software that runs the site. The database started getting really slow. The cluster management software decided that it was too slow and it was time to fail over, which means the one that's active, it's decided isn't healthy enough. So it says, okay, you're done. One of the standbys, you're taking over. When that happened, the standbys weren't warmed up yet, and so they hadn't, and so basically the cluster management software saw that and said, oh, you're also not performing that well, so I'm gonna mark you as not working anymore, and I'm gonna go back to the other one. And luckily that only happened twice before the operations guys came in and said, okay, what's going on here, and stopped it. And then they had like 2 hours of downtime trying to solve the problem. But just that kind of stuff I find very interesting, how those things can go wrong and how people get involved and how things can get worse. Recently, GitLab lost a lot of data because they had an operations guy who decided to just log into the server and try to fix things manually without really like following kind of a handbook or anything like that, and he just deleted a whole lot of really important data. And I don't think they got all of it back, which is kind of awesome. Do you know anything about that?
He thought he was on a different server. And what he was doing was proper if he was where he was supposed to be.
Okay.
And he totally nuked a bunch of stuff.
That's awesome. Yeah, then they had like a YouTube live stream where they were all like just themselves working at computers trying to fix it. And pretty funny.
So when I heard the title of the paper you were going to talk about, or not the title, but what I got was the words folk models, was it?
Folk models, yeah.
Folk models and human factors. And I actually was wondering if it would talk about the good and the bad of it, arguable good. So I mean, like, to me, one example is until about, well, let's call it 10 years ago or so, most of the weather forecasts in Canada were referring to the wind chill in watts per square meter, I believe it is,
okay.
Which gave you some range in the thousands. But it was actually a scientific value. You could say if you put the board in the middle of nowhere and you heat it, the amount of energy you have to apply to keep it at a temperature with this kind of wind at this temperature is this many watts. And it's an awful thing for people to understand.
Right.
But it's scientifically accurate.
Sure.
So they moved away and said, we should have wind chill and just, you know, feels like.
Sure.
So essentially, in a way, it's a bit more folk model-ish, right? Like, I mean, you can explain to a five-year-old a whole lot quicker what feels like means than, you know, 1600 watts per square meter.
Right.
So sometimes it may be a good thing to go towards a folk model. Did they get at that at all, or were they only talking about the detriment of it?
So that's an awesome question. So this paper is just really critical of folk models and just doesn't like them. And that's kind of why, like, I didn't really... so there was the paper about home PC security folk models, that suggested that people who are involved in developing PC security software, so if that's antivirus or if that's whatever else, personal firewalls or whatever, that you should develop your software to match people's folk models so that they already know how to use it based on what they've just kind of picked up over time, rather than forcing them to learn how it actually works, because that is just going to be a losing battle. People aren't really interested necessarily in becoming PC security experts if that's not what they're interested in.
Yeah, those jobs are the worst.
Yep. Yeah, so that paper does definitely say that you should try to follow what people already expect.
Just thinking about folk models now that I know what they are, I swear my entire life is folk models.
Yeah.
All of it. Like driving a car standard, I don't really know how it works. I just have a sort of vague idea about a clutch and you stamp on it hard.
Yeah,
seems
you kinda
legit.
Have to, right? It's too much in
like,
the world.
Like Newtonian physics, kind of a folk model, because it's other stuff.
Do you understand how your stick shift works at the Newtonian physics level?
No. If you've ever heard my car shifting.
For your phone to vibrate and the electromagnetic motor to run, it requires special relativity.
Really? Yeah, so like, exactly, like I think I know how magnets work. I don't actually, no, I actually don't know how magnets work at all.
I've still never heard that song. Insane Clown Posse, how do magnets work and stuff.
Is that actually where that comes from?
Yeah.
I'm like so far removed from that, I've just like heard people repeat.
So a bunch of science, so how do magnets work? It was part of one of their songs, and at one of their concerts, a bunch of people actually showed up to do science demonstrations about how magnets work and things.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Same Clown Posse of all people. Interesting. So have you folks ever done kind of these, been involved in a project, like whether it's software or whether it's like hosting an event where like things have gone wrong and then you've kind of looked back and had to kind of figure out why it went wrong and stuff like that? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Today.
Yeah? Can you talk about it or is it kind of secret?
It's not really secret. We changed the time and we forgot to book the room.
Right, yeah. So like... Great example.
There's even a checklist that I totally didn't instantiate for this event.